The Lord says our body is a temple of God. Not just one part or two, but the whole of it. The Word of God also says that our God is a jealous God. What does it mean when the Bible says that our God is a jealous God? It means that anything or anyone that you give importance to, more than you give importance to God, you give that thing or that one the place of God in your life, and God is jealous of that. The same way, if we love someone, we want that person to love us back with the equal amount, with an equal quantity. If I love someone a lot, and maybe if I love my mom the most, or if I love my dad the most, the same way I will somewhere or the other expect that they should love me more than they love my sister perhaps. But yes, that is how it works when there is someone in our life whom we love a lot. The same way our God loves us. He loves us a lot. At the same time, He does not want us to give anyone or anything a greater priority than God Himself. Now, when we give that priority to anything or anyone, what we do is we cheat on God. We are betraying Him when it comes to that love. And when we are talking about not just, you know, every time we are talking about love here and we are talking about cheating here, the moment we are actually giving any part of our body, maybe if we are doing anything which is, you know, maybe our work sector, if we are cheating in our work and we are trying to gain more money, we are giving that work, that money, a higher priority than our God Himself. That is where the moment we are actually corrupting any part of our body, maybe there you are corrupting your mind as well as your hands. The moment you corrupt it, you become sexually immoral. When the Lord is talking about sexual immorality, and I was asking God, Lord, what do you want to talk? He says, any part of your body, if it is not functioning as per the will of God, you are making yourself sexually immoral. Today's topic that we are going to learn about is sexual immorality. And there are certain points that the Lord put in my heart, and I want to share it with all of you. The first point that we are going to learn, and we are going to learn how to fight sexual immorality, right? So we are going to learn as to what are the things that we need to be aware of. The first thing is consciousness of sin. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 21 says, for our sake He made Him to be sin who knew no sin. This verse is talking about Jesus, where it's written, who knew no sin. And I was asking Lord, what does it mean? And that's where He was saying that, you know, there's a small child. Let's imagine a small child running around the house, okay? And he's running around naked. That small child does not have any thought in his mind. He's just casually playing around in the house. But as he grows up, he'll not run around naked in the house, because he'll start knowing that that is a sin. But was it not a sin when he was a child? What changed? What was the difference? The difference was, he was made aware by his immediate surroundings, by the society, that yes, your nakedness is a sin. Right? So for us to do something, we need to be first aware of things. You know, maybe any sin. If I am talking about smoking being a sin, I need to first know that there is something called smoking. And only when I do it, and only when I smoke, is when I am sinning. When I'm talking about, you know, anything, if I'm actually cheating, lying, everything, for God, everything is the same. You know, there are no levels, like if you are a rapist, you are a big sinner. If you are just a liar, you are a small sinner. No, sorry, God does not work that way. For Him, sin is a sin. There is no, He's not biased when it comes to that. So for us to do something, we have to first be aware of something, or aware of the existence of something. What the Lord was asking is, or what the Lord was showing is, Jesus knew no sin. Let's ask the Lord to remove that consciousness of sin itself. Let's not be aware of something which is called lying. You know, let truth, and truth only, be the portion of our life. let us not be even aware that some, you know, that we can lie or we can cheat. The moment there is something that you do not know exists, you cannot do that, right? As I said, for in order to do something, you need to know what it is. So let's remove the seed of all the sin that the enemy has planted or the devil has planted in your heart or in your mind. Okay, the first thing is where we have to ask God to remove the consciousness of, you know, sin, or the awareness of existence of sin itself. We have to ask the Lord to remove it. Okay, the second thing that we are gonna the second thing that the Lord was talking about, the second point there is take control. In 1 Thessalonians 4 verse 4, it says that each one of you know how to control his own body in holiness and honor. Okay, now when we are again reading this verse, it's not talking about, you know, just taking control of one part of your body or two. Because when we are talking about sexual, the moment we use the word sex or anything related to sexual, we immediately think it's related to our private parts or our genitals. That is all we somewhere, you know, limit ourselves to. But the fact is, when the Lord is talking about this verse, he's talking about the whole body. So what does it mean? So that means that if your eyes are seeing things that they are not supposed to, let's immediately, you know, shut our eyes, turn our eyes away, take action, make sure that you take control of your eyes. If I'm watching something on YouTube or so, there is something that popped up on Facebook, take your eyes off, shut down your Facebook, shut down your laptop or whatever it is. If we are walking around the road and we see something vulgar, do not look at it. Take your eyes off so that you are not consumed by that sin itself. If your ears are listening to things which they are not supposed to, if you are listening to things, people lying, people cheating, gossip, you know, backbiting, if you are listening to things like these from others, let's come to a place where we do not listen. Come out of that situation. Come out of that place. Do not listen to it. Don't be a part of that conversation. If your hands are doing things like, you know, as I was talking in the beginning itself, if you are signing checks, if you are writing, you are filing things and you are doing things which are not right, which are illegal, which are not ethical, which are not moral, let's not do it. Let's take control of our eyes, our hands, our ears, if you are listening, your legs, you know, if you are going to places which you are not supposed to. Refrain from doing it. Take control of your legs. Tell yourself, no, I'm not going to go there, I'm not going to go here. Take the other direction. Simple as that. Now, that's where, you know, even our mouth, we usually, and it's very easy for us to speak harsh words. It's very easy for us to actually say things which we are not supposed to and which is not right. So let's be very much aware that we are not supposed to just take control of just our private parts or just an eye or, you know, your mouth or your hands. No, the whole body. So the list goes on. Even when people might ask, okay, my whole body also has my stomach. Yes, overeating is also a sin. Do not eat beyond your capacity. People have a gluttonic, you know, spirit in them. They see food, they start hogging on it, and they waste half of it because they're not being able to eat the rest. It's not right. So let's take control of our actions here, every single part of our body. You know, because 1 Corinthians 6 verse 18 says, sexually immoral person sins against their own body. Now how sad it is. We are not exactly sinning against anyone else. We are sinning against our own self. We are becoming the reason for our own downfall. Let's not do it. Okay. So the next point that we are going to look into, the next point that is flee. Run. Okay. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 18 again. The verse that we read, when we read the first half, it says flee from sexual immorality. What does it mean by saying flee from sexual immorality? We have an instinct, we have an instinctive habit instinctive in us to be disobedient actually. The moment we are made aware of, we are doing something which we are aware that it's a sin, the Holy Spirit obviously nudges us. The Holy Spirit immediately lets us know that you are sinning. But we have it instinctive in us that we say, you know, a little bit more. If you are watching something which is not right, maybe on YouTube you are watching a vulgar video, something popped up and you are watching, and the next thing you should be doing is shutting down that YouTube. But what you say is, okay, just few seconds more. If you are writing something and doing something wrong, a few seconds more. If you're listening to something, okay, I'll listen a little more. We linger around in the wrong things. The Lord says, the word of God says, flee from those places. If you are amongst your friends who are gossiping, backbiting and talking all kind of nonsense, which is not helping you in any way, run away from those places. Get out of this place. Come to a place which will benefit you in the spirit. Okay? The next point that is, that the Lord was talking about, the next two points are very beautiful. One he says is, he will make a way. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 13 says, God is faithful and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. We start getting entangled. The moment we sin or we have already committed sin, what happens is, we start getting entangled so much in self-pity, remorse, guilt, that we stop looking at God itself. The moment we stop looking at God, the next thing that happens is, you know, as the word of God says, he makes a way for you so that you can come out of it. The wrong things that you have got yourself indulged in, he will make a way for you. But because we are so much drowned in our own sin and we are getting into that remorseful state and guilt state where we are considering ourselves as huge sinners, we do not see our God is making a way for us to come out of it now. He does not want you to stay there. So let's ask God to give us the grace that we can see towards him so that we can see the way that is making for us to come out of things. Come out of our weaknesses. Okay? The last point that I want to talk about is punishment. What if we are not doing it? We are not obeying. And what if we end up actually, you know, continuing the same lifestyle? The Bible says, their portion, in Revelation 21 verse 8 says, their portion will be the lake that burns with fire and sulfur. Now, this is one place which is very scary, you know. Yes, our God loves us a lot. But it's, you know, as true it is that we are alive, we are living a beautiful life and we are made for his glory. Same way, he's also a judge who's waiting to judge his people, who's waiting to judge the whole world. Friends, the result of all of this is nothing but being thrown into the fire of hell, where there is no death. You keep getting burnt. You keep dying, you are again awakened, again you are dying, again you are going, there is a continuous process of pain and suffering for eternity. Let's know that this life is just a speck in the midst of eternity. As I had heard this quotation, I've seen this quotation on Facebook, people usually say life is too short, let's live it to the fullest. But no one ever says that eternity is too long. Prepare before you regret. It touched my heart. We don't understand that the eternity that we are talking about is too huge. It does not have an end. Let's keep our destination being one with Jesus. Heaven, our destination in our mind. Because if we keep getting indulged in all these things, we will fall. And we will miss our destination, that is heaven. Sexual immorality is something that is actually killing people these days. People think it's okay to do certain things. But they don't see what those immoralities are causing, or what kind of effects those immoralities are causing in their lives. Friends, let's grow beyond these things. Let's fight it. Let's ask the Lord to remove the consciousness. Let's immediately ask the Lord to give us a strength to control our whole body. Let's run away from everything or anything that we see is not from God. But at the same time, let's know that he is going to make a way for us, even in the middle of our weaknesses, in the middle of our difficulties. Let's keep our eyes always towards him so that we can see that way. God bless you all. And I believe everyone is going to be blessed. And they're going to grow stronger and stronger in the Lord with every day. God bless you.